So warm welcome to everyone who's joined us here for the 15th episode of Capital Insider series as we take a look at the new age startup capital, which also exists in the ecosystem and has been doing so for quite a while, which is called the venture debt. Now, in very simple terms, if I was to tell you what is venture debt, it is really debt financing, which is done for venture-backed or equity, venture equity-backed companies. And of course, if you do them it rightly, or if you get your venture debt rightly, it can actually be a lot better for startups rather than the risk capital, which is the startup or the VC capital that they usually go for. So today we're joined by Ashish Sharma. He is the Managing Director and CEO of Innoven Capital India Private Limited. And as one of the largest venture debt funds in India and also spread across Singapore, Southeast Asia and China. They have some rocking portfolio companies inside their system, which is companies like MobiQuick, Pepperfry, OU Rooms, Tribo, ShopClue, Zoomcar, Aether Energy, and many others across other markets too. So thank you for joining us today, Ashish. It's wonderful to have you over here. Today, together in this talk, we are really going to look at the ecosystem of the venture debt market and how venture debt is probably going to gain prime importance and should be looked at as a great capital resource for the startups who are looking to grow their business. Let me start with a very basic question, but I think it's always useful, is how does the economics of venture debt really works? I mean, from a startup's perspective, if he was to weigh venture capital and venture debt, how should he make the economics work in his own head before he applies for it?
Yeah, so I mean, we get that question a lot. So the two ways to look at it. One is basic theory, right? So if you think about theory, there is cost to every level of capital. So the cost of equity is obviously higher, and the cost of debt is lower. So one of the things every company, not only startups, but even if Reliance takes a debt, the only reason they take debt is because what they want to do is, on their capital structure, they want to reduce their weighted average cost of capital. So that's the theory. But practically, I'll give an example. So let's say there is a company, Series A company, which has raised $5 million at a valuation of $25 million, right? Which means that they diluted 20%. Now, in their Series B, I mean, they have an option to raise, let's say, $10 million, and let's put a number. Let's say the valuation will be $50 million, right? Which would mean another 20% dilution to the dilution that has already happened. Now, they could choose to say, well, instead of raising $10 million of new capital, equity capital, why don't we raise $8 million of equity capital and $2 million of venture debt, right? So in this case, instead of diluting further 20%, they have only diluted 8 on 50, which is 16%. And technically, they have saved 4% of equity dilution. And the venture debt, I mean, it also comes with some equity kickers, but those are very little on the cap table. So in this example, if this company were to turn out to be, let's say, a very big outcome, let's say if it were to be a unicorn, and if the early stage investors and entrepreneurs could save 4% at an early stage, I mean, that could be worth a lot of money and ownership. So that's a very simple example, but there are a lot of use cases of venture debt which we can get into as we kind of talk through this, this discussion.
Sure. Let me ask you a more pointed area of venture debt is that, particularly for your own portfolio companies, at what stage did they go out and look for venture debt? Was it after they had raised some serious amount of capital, done their Series A, Series B, or was it still in early stages? Did they think of it as a bridge funding arrangement to grow their business? So particularly, what stage of is the startup usually in when they go out and look for venture debt?
So as you, I think you had alluded to in the beginning, I mean, we look for institutionally backed startups, right? So by definition, our strike zone begins when the company has raised some level of institutional capital. Could be just a Series A round, and we can come in even with the Series A. And after that, we can just come in with the Series A round. So pretty much, I mean, again, the size of the check might be different because obviously it's dependent on the size of the company, how much capacity it has from a debt standpoint. But I think, you know, founders should start thinking about venture debt as they are doing their first institutional check. And that's the right time. And, you know, we do a lot of follow-on investments. So there are a lot of our portfolio companies where we might have done 5, 6, 7 transactions. So, you know, so this is not like a one and done relationship. Capital, as they become bigger, as their balance sheets can absorb more debt. I mean, we can continue to kind of support and help them in various use cases as well as optimize dilution. So I think you should start thinking about it as you are, let's say, signing a term sheet even for your Series A.
Okay. So, I mean, so companies which are prior to Series A usually should not think of, I mean, let's say they are at, they've raised a significant angel funding. So that may be too early for venture debt.
I think as a rule, I mean, we look for institutionally backed companies now, you know, for every rule, there could be an exception. If it's the rock star founder, which raised, which put in their own money and raised a very large, you know, I mean, we could probably break that rule. But as a rule, generally, we look for institutionally backed startups.
Sure. And I mean, just for our understanding, how is venture debt different from bank financing? And, you know, why is it that bank financing is very difficult for startups to get? I mean, but at the same time, you know, venture debt is something that they can go for.
See, it's very different because, I mean, frankly, the only reason, you know, players like us exist is because this asset class doesn't fit in within the risk box of a bank, right? I mean, what do banks look for? I mean, banks look for what they call cash flow underwriting, which means they underwrite companies to see whether these companies would be able to generate enough free cash flows to service their debt. So which by definition means that the company should be profitable. So that's one criteria. And, you know, as we know, while there are some profitable companies, but by and large, you know, startups are still investing. There is a cash burn involved. So that's one criteria. The other thing is banks obviously like security, and whether it's, you know, plant and machinery or, you know, it could be real estate. And most of the startups, I mean, largely what they have is in the form of enterprise value and IP. So these are asset light companies which don't have a track record, which are not profitable, which are kind of DNA and understanding to underwrite these companies. So essentially a lot of times, I mean, we, you know, start a relationship with a company and, you know, frankly, as they become larger, we even, you know, introduce them to banks. And as they become larger, banks begin providing certain, you know, short-term financing, working capital kind of things. But, you know, eventually if the company becomes large and becomes profitable, there would be a time where they will get into the strike zone of banks. And our goal is frankly to come in when banks either would not or could not underwrite these companies.
Sure. And what if for our understanding is usually the difference of interest in a bank loan versus a venture debt loan?
I would say, again, it's not the right question because, I mean, it depends on which company, right? So obviously a bank loan to a Tata or Reliance is very different from a bank loan to, you know, 20 crore SME, right? So I don't think so. You can, because it's the nature of the risk is very different. Clearly, when companies become large enough, right, where banks can underwrite, that's not the time, you know, where we can do too much. And you know, clearly, I mean, as I said, I mean, the only reason we exist is because startups generally don't fit in within the risk box of banks.
Correct. And I mean, you know, if somebody has taken a venture debt, when or at what point of time are they expected to return it? Or do you at least, I mean, you know, if for some reason now, for example, we're sitting in the midst of a pandemic, and we've seen moratoriums happening. So are venture debt companies also working on the same model?
Yeah, I mean, so clearly in most companies have to, you know, start making monthly payments. Now for some companies, there may be a period, moratorium period where they need to only service interest. depending on the situation, etc. I mean, we work with founders, we work with the investors in the company to structure things that make sense. But generally, the difference between equity and debt largely is, I mean, equity is high risk, high return. I mean, debt is, our debt is kind of medium risk, medium return expectation. And the companies have to, think about and have the discipline of planning where they can also return the debt over a 2 to 3 year period, depending on the structure of the loan.
Sure. And I mean, I've read that venture debt is really a runway extension for a startup. I mean, that's how they need to regard venture debt when they are looking to raise capital. So what exactly does that imply?
So runway extension is clearly one of the big use cases, but I would say there are a lot of use cases. So in the case of a runway, essentially, if you look at startups, typically the funding cycles are anything between, let's say 15 to 18 months. Now, obviously, if there is a startup that is really, really hot, maybe they are doing, rounds very fast. So today what's happening in EdTech, for example, but generally 15 to 18 months, right? And that's the time the company needs to get to the next level in terms of milestones so that they can attract the next class of investors. And while plans are great, but, things change. It is taking much longer in terms of adoption than what the company thought. Putting in a little bit of debt, gives them more cushion, where instead of having to rush into doing a fundraise, they can delay the fundraise and do it at the right time from a position of strength. But one thing I would definitely highlight is, like, most companies, most good companies don't do a fundraise when they are down. Money in the bank. And a lot of companies actually look at it that way as well, saying, well, I can raise money, but I would rather raise money with $20 million in the bank versus having $10 million in the bank, because that helps them to, have a better negotiating leverage with prospective investors. You don't do a good fundraise when you have to look back in your bank account every month and see, how much money you have left. So that's right. Clearly one of the big use cases. Sometimes companies that are growing exponentially by delaying the fundraise, and those founders know they can always raise money. In fact, their existing investors are happy to, give them more money at higher valuation. But these founders are very, very sensitive about how much dilution and what valuation, they want to do the fundraise at. So we have seen examples where companies, by taking some venture debt, delayed their fundraise to get the right level of valuation, which in there are a few examples which was 50 to 60% higher than if they would have done a fundraise if they didn't have that additional liquidity that venture debt provided. So that's one use case. There are multiple other use cases. Such as there are companies which have a lot of capex and working capital requirements. Now these companies, frankly, because cost of capital is high, cost of equity is high, they don't want to kind of put all their equity money, stuck up in working capital and capex, right? So venture debt can come in there. There are a lot of special case, clean up the cap table, right? Take some money and buy out some of the early investors, buy back rather. There are companies who have used venture debt to acquire other companies where, frankly, they had money in the bank, but if they spend that money to acquire, they would have had to do a fundraise much faster than what they wanted. So a lot of use cases, eventually it's less dilutive, and generally works well both in the upside scenario as well as the downside scenario.
Yeah, so from your perspective as a CEO of a venture debt, what has changed in terms of how you give out venture debt to a startup now versus what you were doing in pre-pandemic? So, particularly for you, how internally the rules have changed. How do you now look at a startup? What parameters do you weigh them on? And you say that, so maybe it could be more sustainability, better unit economics. So, how do you sort of look at those parameters differently now in these last 6 months?
So I would say if you ask me the same question maybe in March, my response would have been different. I think things are a lot stable now. And frankly, if I look at our portfolio, which is fairly large, you know, I think it's a net positive. So more companies and more sectors are benefiting from COVID, have tailwinds than the ones that have headwinds. Where because of the pandemic and the customer behavior, I mean the recovery, the demand destruction has been very high and the recovery is going to take a long time.
Sure.
So in these companies, I mean, yes, if you are a category leader, I think you can still raise venture debt and possibly equity. But, you know, if you happen to be in a competitive space and there is, you know, very limited line of sight to recovery and it will be a slow recovery, I think it becomes a lot more tougher to raise both equity capital as well as debt capital. Now, exceptions will be there for very strong companies. So that's one. I think the second thing is company has. Now, we always have, you know, runway in the back of our mind. But, I mean, has the entrepreneur, has the founder, you know, navigated the crisis well? Have they taken the right actions to keep the company safe and secure, right? Have they, you know, really, you know, changed their business model, made tweaks in line with some pervasive customer behavior changes? Or are they essentially doing a lot of blocking and tackling and really not able to use this as an opportunity? So, you know, beyond that, I mean, the basics are not very different. I mean, just to give you some context, I mean, you know, for us, the Jan to March was very strong. I mean, we closed probably 10, 12 transactions. And then even before it came to India, because we have a portfolio in China, I mean, we had been looking at what's happening with COVID since February. So frankly, you know, April, May, June, parts of July, I think the focus was largely on the portfolio side, trying to work with founders and, you know, other investors and get a better sense on how the recovery is, what kind of actions are being taken. But now, frankly, over the last 2 months, I think things are stable. And as I said, I think the portfolio, you know, is net positive than not, just driven by the fact that a lot of these companies stand to gain with some changes that are happening in the behavior of customers.
Sure. I mean, just for our understanding, do you also, look at SMEs as a prospective client or a prospective, you know, investee for your capital? In any case, maybe not just in India, but maybe even in China or Singapore and other places?
Again, SMEs, I mean, technically, you could argue by the definition, a lot of the startups, early stage startups are like SMEs, but
yeah.
I mean, we stay away from, you know, non-institutionally backed companies. And you know, there is a reason for that. You know, first and foremost, they may have a bank financing and there are a lot of companies which, you know, which are profitable and, you know, which are SMEs and doing good business and been around for 20 years. I mean, that's where banks are happy to, and they can provide collateral in terms of property and other things. I mean, that's really not our segment. I mean, our focus is more new age. Our focus is more, you know, I would say largely tech enabled, but there are a lot of new age brands that have come in as well in the portfolio. And our focus is to work with the companies that have raised some level of institutional capital, because in addition to various things that typically VCs would look at from a startup standpoint, I mean, we also work very closely with the fellow investor community, right? So to some extent, apart from our own assessment on the founder and the company and the sector, I mean, we also lean to fellow investors who we work with very closely, trying to get their cases, trying to understand, you know, why they invested in the company. You know, also talk to investors who might have looked at the company but decided not to invest as to why did they not invest in this particular company. You know, talking to investors and trying to get a sense of, I mean, which are the kind of investors that would be attracted to this company for the next round of fundraise. So, frankly, because we don't spend as much time as an early stage investor would, and we have to rely also, you know, on some of the inputs that we get from the existing investors in these companies, I mean, we stay away from SMEs.
Sure.
That's more of a bank play.
Sure. And I mean, so what kind of companies or how does your portfolio vary in India versus other countries? I mean, you know, how has Venture Debt and its acceptability and the way it is growing and how founders have been using Venture Debt as a tool for or a capital tool for growth different than you've seen in India or in other markets? And what can probably Indian founders learn from international founders in terms of using Venture Debt? So maybe, you know, you can give us some guidelines over there.
So I would say, I mean, again, using Venture Debt, I mean, the use cases are not very different, right? Now, you know, this asset class is a derivative of the overall VC asset class. Overall, you know, so the more companies get funded, the more money comes in from early stage investors and growth stage investors, the more capacity these companies have to take Venture Debt, right? So in a way, it's proportional to the size of the overall industry. And obviously, I mean, if you look at the Valley and China, I mean, both those ecosystems are a totally different level, right? We can't, we are far, far smaller in every aspect, whether you look at the amount of funding, whether you look at the exits and IPOs. Clearly the US is the largest market from a Venture Debt standpoint. Now, India, you could argue, is now kind of after the Valley and China, the third largest ecosystem. Now there are a few other names as well, but you know, it's getting there. So I think, the penetration of Venture Debt in India is still much lower than what you would find in the Valley. I think compared to China, I think the penetration is more or less the same. For us, clearly, China is a big market, though we only started there a couple of years back. So we are still early there. India is the oldest platform. This used to be Silicon Valley Bank India, which got acquired by Temasek in 2015 and kind of renamed as Innovent. India is the oldest platform, and Southeast Asia again has been around for 3.5-4 years. All three markets are important. China clearly is a big market, but India probably we have the best presence given the vintage that we have had. And I think you talked about, any suggestions, other markets to founders. So I would not talk about Venture Debt, but generally, I would say, if I look at China and I get a chance to, kind of sit on the Asia Investment Committee and see what's happening there, some of the deals we do, I think clearly that market, in two or three aspects is far ahead. I think in terms of, I think innovation, particularly as it comes to, some of the new, kind of deep tech, AI, machine learning, all the buzzwords that we keep hearing about. I think, autonomous driving, I think they are far, far ahead, in some cases, much ahead of the Valley as well. I think in terms of scale, how quickly companies are able to kind of go from X to, 10,000X. While in India also, there are some great examples, but the scale there is very different. And finally, I think, a lot of companies are profitable, have path to profitability. A lot of companies have been able to, go public, both in the domestic market as well as the NASDAQ and other New York Stock Exchange, now Hong Kong and some of the China domestic market that they're focusing on. So I think one thing if I have to look at is, two. One is I think while in India, I think there's been great progress on a lot of business models. I feel like when you look at cutting edge, deep tech, product focused companies, there are not great examples. We are now talking on Zoom. The question that comes is why could Zoom not have been invented out of India, right? So product companies, I think, product companies still in India, we have to see a lot more of. Israel is another example where they have actually a lot, great research and, they're very good in security and certain domains that they are very good at. The second is really is I think time has come where, some of our larger companies should go public. And I feel like there are definitely 5 to 10 companies that have the potential in the next couple of years. And while valuations are great, I feel like you kind of grow up once you become public, when you are in the public domain, and that's where you actually get the best price discovery, and you control your own destiny and are not dependent on just funding. So those would be the two aspects I would like to see more. And based on, you know, the progress so far, I mean, I'm pretty confident that over the next few years, I think on both these aspects, we will see a lot more progress out of India.
Sure. So we've got some questions on Facebook. Saurabh is asking, now that RBI has brought startups under the priority list and startups can get up to rupees 50 crore loans, how will that change the dynamics for the VC or the venture debt ecosystem?
In fact, I was on one or two panels when this announcement came. Unfortunately, like many announcements, you know, as you look at the problem statement was not that the banks did not have liquidity or the banks could not afford to give money to startups. The problem statement was that banks are either unwilling or, as part of their risk policies, cannot provide long-term financing to startups. And, you know, frankly, nothing changes with that. Because today, if any bank wanted to give money to startups, I mean, you didn't need this priority sector lending because, you know, startups anyway, you don't need any pricing advantage. Banks' cost of fund is very low. So so I don't think so this actually solves any issue meaningfully. Maybe it might help a few large companies with respect to pricing, but by and large, I don't believe, this solves anything.
Sure. So Dave is asking that any particular sectors who are going to enjoy the venture debt interest more than other sectors?
So the point is more in terms of interest rate or where we have more interest and focus in terms of certain sectors?
Which sectors are interesting you more today? And, you know, obviously you mentioned about the headwind and tailwind. So I think that's where the question shoots from, that, you know, what sectors are you sort of more gung-ho about in some sectors where you would not want to look at giving away the venture debt?
So before answering that, I would say, I mean, clearly as a business, I mean, we are sector agnostic and stage agnostic. I mean, we have backed probably 8 or 9 unicorns in India, big names. In some of these cases, we came in when they were not unicorns. I mean, names like a Swiggy or a Baiju's or, you know, Oyo Rooms and, you know, some of the bigger names like that. We are stage agnostic, sector agnostic. However, if you look at what's happening today, clearly, our bias is towards industries and companies where there's more visibility around demand, where we can, we believe that actually the pandemic is actually a net positive for those companies because of certain changes that are happening in those customer segments. So it will be the usual suspects. I mean, you look at, you know, EdTech, I think e-commerce, there are companies which gain from e-commerce. Like, we have a lot of logistics companies and some of them primarily third-party logistics company, which primarily focus on the e-commerce segment. Hyperlocal is again, we have a few companies in the portfolio, hyperlocal grocery delivery or other kind of hyperlocal companies. I think health tech is in a decent space. I would say agri-tech, while there was some supply chain disruption in April and parts of May, but has come back very strongly. So clearly, I mean, whether you are equity investor or venture debt, frankly, it's the same companies, the same founders. So you would essentially want to focus on companies that have tailwinds. Having said that, I mean, we are also looking at some large companies where possibly either they didn't feel the use of venture debt, but maybe now, and these are big companies, you know, they're category leaders, where while the business might have suffered some challenges, but, you know, I mean, they're strong companies, right? So they are open to bolstering their, liquidity because they can raise money, frankly. The issue is they don't want to raise money at the wrong time, at the wrong valuation. They would rather recover and then grow from where they were pre-COVID. So I think those will be the sectors where the focus is a bit higher. I think I would say even parts of enterprise. So enterprise SaaS companies, depending on which sectors and what kind of services you offer, there is some tailwinds there as well. So tailwind sectors, I think large category leaders or number two, even number one, number two in large categories. And clearly, there are certain sectors which we would rather look at it from a bit of caution. So whether it's travel or hospitality or parts of mobility or companies that are largely offline, you know, things of that nature.
Sure. So, you know, finally, to sum it up, you know, what sort of readiness do you want a startup to have before they actually apply for a venture debt? I mean, you know, maybe two or three pointers that you can share, whether it's about their books or whether it is about their founder's own, you know, business. So anything, you know, you say that, okay, this shows that you have greater readiness for venture debt.
Well, because, I mean, we come in with or after a company has raised an institutional round. I think purely, I mean, they don't need to prepare something because, you know, frankly, in the equity round, there is a lot more in-depth due diligence that happens. So I think in terms of, you know, information and what traction they have and products and demos, I mean, they've already done a lot of work. And especially in growth stage, late stage, they have, you know, a lot of information, right? So I think it's less about, you know, the readiness is more to do with, I think once you sign your first term sheet, you should start thinking about venture debt. And frankly, it's just another, you know, the color of the money is the same, whether it's debt or equity, it's just the money in the bank, right? The use cases are different. I think you should start thinking about as you are trying to close your, let's say, first institutional check. I mean, you get to know the, some of the venture debt players. And in fact, we also proactively engage with companies even before, you know, they might have closed the series A round. Maybe they have closed the large angel or they've closed pre-series A round. So I think it's more to get educated, look at the use cases. Maybe as you're thinking, planning about your fundraise, you can already say, okay, you know, in addition to this, I can layer in this much more venture debt. So I mean, those would be the things. And frankly, there are certain cases, you know, certain businesses where maybe venture debt may not be the most optimal. So, you know, if you're a very early stage company, maybe you've raised some equity, but it's a binary outcome. It's a very high risk kind of a business, right? Only IP driven, either it works or it doesn't work. I mean, there might be certain founders who may not be comfortable raising debt because in their mind, you know, debt comes with an obligation, at least a moral obligation and a contractual obligation to pay back. While there is, even when you take equity, you have a moral obligation to generate returns for your equity investors, but there is no contractual obligation to pay money back, right? So I think it's just kind of thinking through the use cases and planning as you're doing your fundraise, whether it's your first fundraise or the second fundraise. I think keeping venture debt as an integral part of your financing rounds, that's what we are seeing a lot of smart founders do these days.
Sure. Okay, great. Thank you so much for talking to us, Ashish, and making us more aware about really the workings of venture debt. I'm sure if our audience has more questions on venture debt and its working and how can they best you know, apply for venture debt, please leave your questions on our Facebook Live talk. You can see our handles right here. And we love for Ashish or some of his team members who can answer these questions for you and probably give you some more ideas on raising venture debt. Until we are able to meet each other in person, I think this is the best way where we can actually resolve most of our queries and get more educated and get wiser as we sit in our homes looking for business opportunities outside. Thank you very much for joining us, Ashish. It was wonderful talking to you.
Thanks, enjoyed the discussion.
Yes, likewise. Thank you.